Good morning. We are going to start our service with In My Heart There Rings a Melody. Oh, you may stand if you would like to.
I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above.
The next one is hymn number 156, Ring the Bells of Heaven.
Ring the bells of heaven, there is joy today, for a soul returning from the wild. See the Father meets him out upon the way, welcoming his weary wandering child. Glory, glory, how the angels sing. Glory, glory, how the loud harps ring. 'Tis the ransomed army, like the mighty sea, pealing forth the anthem of the free. Ring the bells of heaven, there is joy today, for the wanderer now is reconciled. Yes, the soul is rescued from its sinful way, and is born anew a ransomed child. Glory, glory, how the angels sing. Glory, glory, how the loud harps ring. 'Tis the ransomed army, like the mighty sea, pealing forth the anthem of the free. Ring the bells of heaven, spread the feast today. Angels swell the glad triumphant strain. Tell the joyful tidings, bear it far away, for a precious soul is born again. Glory, glory, how the angels sing. Glory, glory, how the loud harps ring. 'Tis the ransomed army, like the mighty sea, pealing forth the anthem of the free.
You guys would bow with me. Dear Lord, I praise you for this beautiful day, and thank you for these fellow Christians that have joined us to worship you, and I pray that we will have a great service and a wonderful Sabbath. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, ladies, and good morning. Happy Sabbath. Shabbat Shalom. I don't think anybody's out there this morning. Happy Sabbath. Shabbat Shalom. Wow. So I see we're missing a few gentlemen from the audience today. Did you pass them on your way down? Jim, did you pass them on your way down?
Yeah, right.
I was up in McCall yesterday, too. I wonder how many of the people I passed on my way back down from work as they were coming up. So we have a few announcements this morning. Did the ladies all enjoy your wreath making last time you made it? All ladies are invited to another wreath making evening of fun. Bring any flowers or ribbons you would like to share and join us this Thursday, April 18th at 6 p.m. Please remember that the start time has been moved earlier to accommodate early work schedules. And the men's breakfast has been canceled for this month. Here's an important one. The Lord's Supper service has been scheduled for Sunday evening on April 21st at 8 p.m. Stanton's annual fundraiser is coming up later this month if you want to start saving your change. And there is a young adult retreat this year. It will be June 5th through the 9th. The theme is Rekindle the Fire, and it is for ages 18 to 28. If you have any questions, see Alicia or Danae. There is a flyer on the bulletin board with a QR code. If you don't know what a QR code is, apparently you don't need to attend. It means you're too old. At this time, if Earl will come forward, he has an announcement, and then he will take your prayer requests and testimonies.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So last month we had a dinner and game night. Who all went to that? Did you guys have fun?
Yeah.
Well, we're planning another one on May 11th at 6:30. Different than the last one. This time we will have a set menu, and you'll know what the menu is. So you don't have to guess what you're going to be getting. We actually will have cuisine from four different countries, from Korea, India, Ethiopia, and France. So it's going to be a four-course meal. And there's going to be a mystery that you'll have to solve. There's going to be a skit, and they'll be acting out different parts of the mystery. And your goal is to try to solve the mystery before the gumshoe does. So it should be fun. I'm excited. I'm excited to try other foods that I haven't made before. But come and join us on May 11th at 6 o'clock. Yeah, if I can get someone to do this, we'll get your prayers.
Savior has ransomed me,
amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secure. And push me as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy
This coming Sunday is when we are going to be doing the Lord's Supper, starting at sundown because the Passover was to be done between the evenings, you know, and so forth. If you start looking at all the things that go on during that, one of the interesting things is, when was Easter? When did they celebrate Easter this year? March 31st, wasn't it? Do you know why it's that way? The Catholic Church decided that they did not want Easter to any time, in any place during history. They didn't ever want it to coincide with Passover, because they were being pretty anti-Semitic at that point, and so they scheduled it in such a way that it would never fall at the same time, even though supposedly it's about that, supposed to be about that time. Interesting how people do that. If you look at a lot of the things that were going on there, with Jesus had six trials that night, back and forth between Herod and the Sanhedrin and all those other places. There were illegal things done at every single one of those trials. Some of the judges were there when he got arrested. That was wrong. Just things that all the stuff that they violated. And even the representative of the ruler of the earth at that time, which would have been Pilate, he was a representative of Caesar. He declared Jesus to be innocent, and yet Jesus was crucified. So there's a lot of, if you ever really get a chance to get in and study it and see all the timing that's going on with the Bible, being that he was raised on the 17th of Nisan, if you look in and connect that with Genesis, you find out that that's when the ark landed on the earth. And it's just, God's timing is just so incredible in the way he's arranged everything. At this point, if the worship team, is it a duo this time? If you'll come forward, and then also those who take up the offering will come forward, will take up the offering. If you all bow your heads with me. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the many blessings that you have given us, Lord. We see a lot of evil going on in this world, but we know that you are always in charge, Father, and that you will, your will be done on earth. Father, we ask now that you bless this offering as we take it up, and as a way of showing you our gratitude for all the ways that you have blessed us. Please be with each and every member here and those that aren't able to be here. These things we ask and pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Have a good Sabbath.
To the Lord.
Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow in sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered along. Then like the blind man, God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow in sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I was a fool to wander and stray. Straight is the gate. For the right, praise the Lord. I saw the light. I saw the light. I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow in sight. Praise the Lord. I saw the light. So glad morning when this life is over.
Thank you.
Would you pray to open our service?
Day that we can be here for the Sabbath and enjoy the time with one another and the time to worship you. Be with us as I bring the word and as I preach what you've spoken to us and expound on it. And be with us no matter where we're going after this church service, that you'd take care of us through the Sabbath. And just thank you that this day of rest to focus on you. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, thanks. There we go. All right, so today I'm going to be speaking about from the book of Joel. I'm just going to do a overall view of it. Now, it's one of the minor prophets, so it's like the rest of the books in the middle of the Bible. It's sort of overlooked. It's the flyover country between the narrative in places like the Kings or the books of the law and in between the Gospels. But I think I've got a personal affinity for these books, and I feel like they're this bridge between the two that unless you understand what's in the middle, you don't quite understand what Jesus is trying to say some of the time. But even though it's just three chapters, it's not any less valuable. And I definitely know that giving it one sermon isn't going to give it the due it deserves, but that can be said about pretty much anything else in the Bible too. So unlike some of the other prophets, we know a lot about Isaiah's life. We know something about Amos and some of the others, but we just basically all we have to go on with who Joel is just his father's name. And we can't really pin it to any sort of specific time in the Bible events either, because there's what he's talking about is something that probably happened more than once. Now, numerous suggestions have been tossed out. There's anywhere from somewhere around Hezekiah or the middle of the Kings till well beyond the exile. And even the suggestion that it's composite authors but there's no real pinning it down at all. While there are some quotes or references to other prophets in this book, there isn't really any. He's probably writing after some of those books were already written, but there's just so much that we don't know about who he was and what time he was speaking to. But that in some ways that's not as important, because he wrote about events that related to things that were happening at the time he was writing. But at the same time, those events were resounding beyond the time when he was writing. So even now, far removed from any context or any knowledge of what happened back then, we can still glean quite a bit from this. So before we get any, so he's going to be talking a lot about locusts. And before you can't understand the book of Joel without understanding what a locust is. And so in English, it was just the word for grasshopper from Latin. And there's the Hebrew words that Joel uses throughout the book also reflect that he was talking about grasshoppers. And normally they're solitary creatures, and they're not venomous. They don't have a stinger or a pincher, or they don't bite, and they eat plants. So if you're persistent, a 6-year-old who's persistent enough can catch it. Because one of my daughters was able to catch one time and holding her hands, and I don't have to worry anything about her being stung or in danger of the fact that there's a grasshopper in her hands. And they're not poisonous either, because there's lots of people who eat them. And what's more, they're also clean. Like John the Baptist didn't seem to mind. I haven't had the chance to test it out myself, but I'm assured they taste good if you prepare them right. But then in some species of grasshoppers, though, there's these switches that are in them, these environmental stressors that happen. Either there's too many of them, they're overpopulated, or there's a drought or some other trigger that happens environmentally, and this switch flips in them, and they undergo this transformation. They start getting bigger and changing color. They start getting hungrier. They start seeking each other out more often and lay more eggs, which also come up as locusts. And eventually they start flying, and they start forming groups and larger groups and start flying longer and longer distances searching for food. And before long, you have billions of them just swarming the skies. I don't know if anybody saw this a few years ago, but there was a period in, in Las Vegas where they had a swarm of grasshoppers that just came into town for a few days. And I don't know what they found to eat, but it was just the fact that they were in there and they were hopping around in front of modern buildings. And it's it's amazing just how many there are and what they can actually do. But back then, where you're reliant on eating what you grew and the farms you were living on, if this showed up in your doorstep, then you were pretty much done for the season at least. There's going to be end results that domino effect from that idea of somebody's eating all our crops. And clearly this must have happened to Israel because Joel wrote about it. I know there's a few, the minority view, John Calvin included, kind of thought that this was a metaphor for an army of humans. I think it's the other way around, where he's using the locusts as a metaphor for armies, or using the armies as a metaphor for locusts. The idea that they're consuming and destroying just like a regular human army would. And then the second, when you go into this book, is the second idea that you should keep in your head is the idea of the day of the Lord. Now, this comes up somewhat often in the Old Testament prophets. Joel is the one that uses it the most out of all of them, but it's usually coming up to describe this like day of crisis or this day of judgment, and something that's unmistakably beyond human has happened, and they're responding to it or they're predicting it. But the one thing to remember though is that there's been multiple days of the Lord according to those prophets, everything from the fall of Jerusalem to this event that Joel's writing about, where it's this one instance in time. But while it can be used to reference a future, the final judgment sort of situation, it is just most of them are talking about single events in time that have happened and come and gone. And it can be positive or negative. Sometimes it's the day of a natural disaster or warfare against Israel, but also be the day when God acts to save his people. It was common enough. We can look in Amos 5, 18 through 20, where it says, "Woe to you who long to the day of the Lord. Why do you long for the day of the Lord? That day will be darkness and not light. It'll be as though a man fled from a lion only to meet a bear, as though he entered his house and rested his hand on the wall, only have a snake bite him. Will not the day of the Lord be darkness and not light, pitch dark without a ray of brightness?" So it must have been common in the culture to say they were waiting for the day of the Lord to happen, for God to come and fix their problems. And yet Amos saw this judgment coming where he saw this blind spot those people had of not being able to recognize their own sins. And the problem, if you read further into Amos, talks about the idea that as much as they call on the Lord, they have forgotten what he actually asked for. And no matter what, though, good, whether it's a good day or a bad day of the Lord, everybody who's experiences it will have their strength fail in the face of what God has done and the fact that it's unmistakable that God has acted in this moment. So digging into the text, in the first few verses, hear this from Joel 1:2. We said, "Hear this, you elders. Listen, all who live in the land. Has anything like this ever happened in your days or the days of your ancestors? Tell it to your children. Let your children tell it to their children and their children to the next generation. What the locust swarm has left, the great locusts have eaten. What the great locusts have eaten, the young locusts have eaten. What the young locusts have eaten, the other locusts have eaten." And it's this once-in-a-lifetime event that Joel is saying, write it down so you don't forget about it. It's this historical day that nobody else is, unless you write it down like he is doing now, then he's not going, then it's something you want to tell your grandkids about. The one day when these swarms, there are different words for the types of locusts he's saying, he mentions in verse 4, but they all point to the idea of they're pulling apart, they're swarming, they're consuming. It's all different waves of these things coming and eating everything in sight. And verse 6 talks about how a nation is invading my land, a mighty army without number. It has the teeth of a lion, the fangs of a lioness. It has laid waste my vines and ruined my fig trees. It stripped off their bark and thrown it away, leaving its branches white. And he's talking about all these things that have happened and everybody is suffering equally, from the drunkards in the street who are waiting for the wine to come, to new brides, to the farmers, and he also talks about the idea that there's nothing left even to tithe. So even the priests are suffering from this crisis that's come on the land, because the priests were dependent on the fact that everybody else had to pay a share of their harvest in order to feed them, because they didn't have the land to take care of themselves. And in the words that he's using, though, Joel is not excluding himself from this problem. He's not pointing fingers. He's not this priest, this preacher who's separating himself from the people who are suffering. He isn't trying to figure out what sin caused this to happen in the moment. He isn't trying to score points or figure out how he can get one over on somebody else. Instead, he's got this, he's expressing this mourning, just like everybody else in this country is doing the same thing. And you look back to different instances where people have mourned over these major losses. You go back to Job's friends, and for all the scorn that he heaped on them when they showed up, the first thing they did was actually sit and be with him and in his moment of crisis. And there's no real sane reason for you to cheer for a house fire or to be on the side of a tornado who's devastating somebody. Sometimes just a tragedy is a tragedy, and sometimes a Christian response is to just mourn with somebody who's hurting. There's not to try to figure out what policy we can change, what person caused this. Sometimes sadness and mourning is always the sadness and mourning will always be the appropriate first response. We can sort of see this also in some of Jesus' teachings, going to Luke 13, talking. Now, somebody had come up and brought up a situation from his day, discussing these random disasters that fall on people and don't seem to have a connection to things. And apparently, Pilate had murdered people in this horrible act that people just had to talk about, and Jesus happened to be there to hear it. But Jesus says in verse 2, "Do you think these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered this way?" Talking about their murder. "I tell you no, but unless you repent, you too will all perish. Or those 18 who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than all the others in Jerusalem? I tell you no. But unless you perish, you repent, you too will all perish." So again, it's not that these people who were involved or who were hurt had any more sins than anybody else. It's just that the disasters can befall the righteous and the unrighteous alike. But Jesus used that idea of there's chaos, there's a randomness to it sometimes, as an opportunity to say, repent while you still can, because you know what's going to happen tomorrow. And going back to Joel, let's see. Going back to Joel 1:13, where I'll be reading from next. He sets up a solution finally. There's a time for mourning, there's a time to potentially do something about it. There's nothing to do but to pray and fast, as he says. "Come spend the night in sackcloth, you who have ministered before my God, for the grain offerings and drink offerings were withheld from the house of God. Declare a holy fast and call a sacred assembly. Summon all the elders and all who live in the land to the house of the Lord and your God, and cry out to the Lord." So it's this inhuman. There's this crisis they're experiencing that's beyond the capacity of any human to really understand or turn it around. So there's only one place to go, is that it's to God who is bigger than the plague, who is bigger than the crisis we're dealing with. And it's not that this is a punishment. It's not that it's an Exodus sort of situation where there's a direct cause for it. But there's nothing good coming. We look ahead to the fact that there's no more food that's being stored up. There's none of these. The crops that we're counting on aren't there anymore. So there's a drought and further crises that are coming up. That even the environment itself is suffering. He even talks about the fact that the fields are burning up and the wild animals even don't have enough water to drink. And even they're crying out for God. So why shouldn't we as humans see this? And so he changes, in the next few verses, he changes his focus and to retell the disaster and making it more vivid, more poetic. And as he's talking about what's happened, he's, like I said, he never describes the sins that caused this. Either there's an assumption that you've read these other prophets and you have an idea of what's going on, or that this is not something he's trying to tie back to a sin in particular. But whatever it is, it's unprecedented. He describes in these terms of a disaster, or darkness, these clouds, a fire. He starts talking about it like an army. It's this inhuman force. Like, it's beyond the efficiency, the power of any military might. It's billions greater than any of those. And it's not, again, we're not talking about a supernatural force in this case, but we're talking about an inhuman one. And while he's using these military metaphors of chariots and warfare and marching like soldiers and conquering a city, it's really, it's and you can't fight it on a human scale. Students of history can think back to all the ways that that conquerors have been turned back in the world, whether it's they can be tricked or outsmarted. There's an alliance with somebody else. They get voted out of office. They run home to solve some crisis. But there's no way to do that with locusts. There's no way to do. You can't find the hurricane's enemies and team up against it. You can't have your king's daughter marry the prince of the wildfire. They're just beyond these human reasons. The idea of the idea of the hyper object, the thing that you cannot get your hands across. Whether it's something like the economy or climate change, where it has these effects that are beyond one person's understanding to see all the ways it acts in the world. And this is, to Joel, this is what he's seeing, is that it's just bigger than what he can do. So that's one of the reasons why he's calling so hard for people to call to God, because he's the only one who can bail them out of any of this problem. And Joel's not satisfied with this, going back to verse 2:11, he applies this and says, "The Lord thunders at the head of his army. His forces are beyond number, and mighty is the army that obeys his command. The day of the Lord is great, it is dreadful, and who can endure it?" And he's not satisfied with just being a inhuman event that you shrug your shoulders and you move on from, because he seems to tie it to, he raises questions that we have to answer in some ways today, is that if God is in charge of these events, does this preclude our ability to take precautions against them? Does it change the way we react to them? And one thing that came to mind when I was reading this and thinking about those questions was the example of Joseph, is that while he didn't have control of the climate or the famines that were coming, he still had this presence of mind to say, there is a way to take care of the people who are going to be affected by this. There's ways to survive this and come out just fine. And he, by demonstrating that in his actions, he showed that it's possible, even in the day of the Lord, to take precautions against it. And there's this idea in the Christian philosophy of the idea of the problem of evil, saying, how can an all good God coexist with the idea of evil and sin happening in the world? And one answer that I've heard is that that a lot of it is more about our responses to that suffering and how we as Christians act in the moment where it's happening. What are we doing to alleviate or justify as right or ignore these sufferings, and the pain of other people in our world? But I think the answer is to compare how our reactions compared to what Christ would do in those situations. And the Gospels, where we see the times where he condemns and judges people for their hypocrisy or the way they twisted the teachings of God or the law. But when it comes to the weak and the suffering, Jesus is listening to their pleas for help, and he heals and he feeds people who are hungry. He fixes what's broken in body and soul. And sometimes he explains that the reason they're suffering is not because of any sins they committed, but because God's glory will be shown in it. And even for the people who are watching who weren't healed, Jesus still has messages that point them towards the God who sent him to work in the world and make disciples of them. And in the same way, Joel turns back to the response. And beyond the event itself, this disaster, it's about what happens next. And finally, halfway through the book, Joel finally gives us a message from God directly. And this is the closest we can come God explaining himself for what's going on. And Joel 2:13 says, "Rend your heart, not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. Who knows? He may turn and relent to leave behind a blessing, grain offerings and drink offerings for the Lord your God." So it's this reminder that God seems to say of rededicating yourself. He will provide even for the priests who have lost, and he's now that it's gone, now that there's the disaster seems to have passed, there's still this is an opportunity to rededicate yourself. And it's also this reminder that, going back to the idea of Deuteronomy and the fact that that Israel signed a contract with God, that if you do this, then God will provide all these things for you. But if you break these commandments, then these curses will fall upon you. But it's in the way that God has said this, put this message out, it's reminding them that their ultimate responsibility is to God, and that while God upholds his part, the Israelites have to uphold theirs. And even with this disaster, the contract is not broken, but it's this reminder that they need to follow through with their obligations in it. And he goes back, and Joel goes back to the idea of bringing people together, have an assembly, have talk about it, show your devotion to God, and show that we are not breaking our side of the contract, that God still has as long as we're showing our obligation, God will show his favor to us. And it seems to have succeeded. Verse 18 in chapter 2 talks about how the Lord took pity on his people and sends wine and olive oil enough to satisfy you fully. Never again will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. And as unpleasant it is to have these dead locusts everywhere, after it's done, it's that God has acted to save his people. It's this is the other side of the day of the Lord, where it's time to restore. Surely God is the one to restore both the people, and he goes on to describe how the countryside is restored too. It's not just the persons, it's the environment that's been wrecked. It's all these things that have come back. And it goes beyond just the physical restoration as the day of the Lord of both destroying and putting back together. It's more than just the grain and the wine and the oil coming back. Is that God is going to do something that's better than they asked for. And one day, everybody in Israel will see God act if they haven't already. And if they've somehow missed the provision, if they missed the disaster, God will make himself known to the people. And not just the priests, but everybody else in Israel is going to see him acting in it. He'll pour out his spirit. So verse 28 talks about how afterward I'll pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. And your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I'll pour out my spirit in those days. I'll show my wonders in the heavens, and on earth, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So this is something that cannot be explained away as a coincidence or natural event anymore. This is God acting towards his people. And even if you miss that the messages, the things that are being said, God will create events in the heavens that people will see, and somehow even people who are just seeing that will see that God is acting and something unusual is happening. And going back to the last week in the eclipse and the idea of going from in Joel, it seems to be this disaster because they couldn't predict it, and there were other cultures who did, though, and we can predict it years, and it's years out in advance. And the idea of these eclipses and these events in the sky going from these disasters to proclamations of God's glory, a glimpses of what he's doing. And I just thought that no matter what happens in the heavens and or individual people, God's name, everyone who calls on God's name will be saved. Come whatever locusts, whatever signs of the heavens, whatever else comes next. And this is the other side of that day of the Lord that he preaches about. But even with this restoration, even with this idea that God is going to be poured out on the people around him, there's going to be more to be said. And the locusts are sort of forgotten. It's already happened, so let's move on to something different. And Joel's viewpoint, like a lot of these prophets, there's this interpolation of what's happening now, what's happening in the future, and he doesn't make the same distinctions that we might about asking when it might happen. It's the fact that it's going to happen. It's seen ahead of you. I've heard the analogy of mountains, that you don't see which mountain is the closest to you. You just see mountains in the distance. But you don't know which one's further, which one's closer. All you see is one big continuous block. And that's the way a lot of the prophets saw the future, is that it's just, I'm going to say one thing and another, but it's all going to be part of a continuous whole, and I can't say which one's going to come next, just that they're all coming in the future. And so God explains his purpose again, is that he's in chapter 3 about how every nation is going to be judged according to what they did to Israel. God has a rhetorical question. Are you paying me back? Are you paying me for something I have done? God says, if you're paying me back, I'll swiftly and speedily return on your own heads what you have done. And he condemns them. This is unlike Israel, where he sort of skips over their sins, God in this part of it is laying out what actually happened and how they damaged Israel and the conquests. All these things are going to come back on the people who are committing them. This is a theme from another prophets like Habakkuk, where it talks about how eventually this evil will come back on the people who are committing it. You've sold people as slaves, so you're going to experience the same disasters on your own self. And this is the true day of the Lord. This is the final one that's after all the smaller ones. This is the last one to happen. And one day, God says, the judgment is going to come as this total war between the people of Israel, not just the people of Israel, not even the people of Israel. God is just going to invite the armies of the Lord, armies of the nations to fight against each other. There's this reversal of themes seen in Isaiah, for example, where in verse 9 he talks about how they're, instead of the familiar verse in Isaiah, talks about turning your swords into plowshares, taking your weapons of war and turning them into farming equipment. And in this case, they're going backwards. They're neglecting feeding themselves even to build these war machines, make swords out of every piece of metal they can find. And Joel prophesies this time where all of these nations are coming, this day of the Lord is coming to Israel's enemies. And while this isn't, and just like with the locusts though, this isn't a day where military conquest or human power is what wins the day. It's not the matter of being overcome in some battle or outsmarting them or outmaneuvering them. It's about the idea that God is acting directly to save his people and causing his enemies to be destroyed. And in the same way that the signs were seen in the heavens at the end of this, at the end of chapter 2, those signs are also going to be seen in the rest of the world. And this outpouring of, while other prophets spend a lot of their time talking about Israel's sin, Joel closes out by focusing on everybody else's, all the other nations. And it seems to be that either the locusts have been punishment enough for a time, or this is speaking about a future date when God's people have been sanctified. There's not a worry for sin. There's a salvation and outpouring of spirit. And Israel has finally gotten the point of it all. And there's nothing left to do but judge the rest of the world. excuse me. Well, and this is something that's in our class in the mornings, we've been going over the Sermon on the Mount, and we're going to get to it, but the idea of meekness is something that's come up and that's going to come up. And sometimes, making a New Testament connection, sometimes it's translated gentleness, sometimes it's a fruit of the Spirit, but it's not being passive, it's sometimes described to be. It's a restraint. In the Greek New Testament word is the same word used to describe a horse under control, as it's a powerful animal that's several times your weight and size, and yet somebody, a skilled rider, can control it with just a few pieces of rope and a bit in its mouth. And it's under whatever power it has is under that animal, that rider's control. In showing meekness, you don't lash out at every insult that you see or every problem in front of you. It's not knee-jerking at every crisis that comes upon you, but it's understanding that there's an ultimate judgment belonging to God, and it is not your job to mete out punishment for every wrong that you suffer. If there's some sort of failure to do right on our part, then God is going to act us for the weakness that we show, and he's going to be the one who acts in his time and make it right. And again, going back to the book of Joel, to his explanation for what everything is going on, God makes another statement in verse 17-21. Then you will know that I, the Lord your God, dwell in Zion, my holy hill. Jerusalem will be holy. Never again will foreigners invade her. In that day, the mountains will drip new wine, and the hills will flow with milk. All the ravines of Judah will run with water. A fountain will flow out from the Lord's house, will water the valley of Acacias. But Egypt will be desolate, Edom a desert waste, because of the violence done to the people of Judah, in whose land they shed innocent blood. Judah will be inhabited forever in Jerusalem through all generations. Shall I leave their innocent blood unavenged? No, I will not. The Lord dwells in Zion. So God, again, makes an explanation for what's going on, and that through all these punishments, through all these events, both in their time and the whatever future is coming, God is still making a statement that he is Judah's God and their true ruler, that he still blesses his own people. He's reversing whatever misfortune they've gone through, and there's streams that are better than just mere water, but they're milk and wine and plenty. And at the same time, though, he's drawing a line between Israel and their enemies by saying that they're going to remain wastelands, but God's people are going to be blessed in the day of the Lord. And he's ending with justice, that whatever wrongs have done have been made will be made right. Whatever sins have been done have been forgiven, because the Lord lives in Zion, and his justice is the one that lasts forever. And this is the final. This is what he's trying to do in the final day of the Lord, bring about this completeness, that he is demonstrating that he is God, and he is the one who is going to save you in the end. Now, in the meantime, in the Northwest, we don't have the same natural disasters like we have in like other places. Other parts of the country, other parts of the world have hurricanes or tornadoes or earthquakes. We're pretty stable here. There's the occasional droughts and wildfires, but they're not the same degree that a hurricane does. As much as we can predict that, there's still people who are affected by those things. And we don't have the same conflicts or warfare or instability that other countries have in the terms of their government and who rules them. The closest we can probably point to for the Day of the Lord that we can all remember is one might be September 11th, one might be the COVID pandemic and the effects that happened from them. But there's these rare events that have happened that affected everyone almost equally. And I'm not saying that those were God's judgments or reaction to sin, but again, it goes to these responses to disasters that are out of our control, that we feel in our lives. And right, as I said before, there's been multiple days of the Lord, and there will be continue to be multiple days of the Lord. There are other people who are having it right now. And looking at the example of Joel, a lot of what he talks about are people's responses to it. And what Joel did is he responded to it by recognizing that it's beyond our control to stop, but also recognizing that there's hurt and there's suffering that needs to be alleviated. Regardless of what's happening to those people, there's humans being affected, that Jesus, and going beyond just what Joel saw, we can see that Jesus died for them just as much as he did for us. And wherever people are suffering, it becomes necessary for us to share in that in some way, even recognizing it, even doing what we can, whatever we need to be doing. If God is speaking us to alleviate somebody's suffering, we should be doing it. The next step is, again, going back to those ones that we've experienced in our own world, those, whether it's COVID or whether it's September 11th, those things, events cause us to reconsider how we've been arranging our lives, how we've set up society, and how we've maybe revealing sins that we hadn't seen before. Either it's whether it be personally in each individual life or a community idea, that this reconsideration of how we've been living our life, though, according to Joel, should include repentance. That we should see those sins and we should see the opportunities to fix them, to adjust how we've been living our lives, to see the brokenness that we've ignored or we've justified, and the people around us who are looking to us to see how Christians experience crisis and deal with it. And every one of these moments of, whether it's large or small or whatever else, everyone is an opportunity to show compassion to somebody else. Either we can do direct action to help or be emotionally supportive, or even just thinking about if it's not in our circle, then we can think about the words we use to describe those things and the people being affected. And if we do that, then the Spirit of God will be poured out on us, and other people will see Jesus through us by the way we live our lives and the way we respond. And again, sometimes it does take a big hiccup to see outside of ourselves and see that we have chances to start over and to be forgiven. And every crisis that we experience or see is an opportunity to change our view on people or on God or how we live our own lives. But it's also how we can see that God has acted in them and how he's willing to restore whatever's been damaged in our own society or our own personal lives. God is ready to hear us whenever we seek him out, whether it's before or after these lesser days of glory, but for sure before any final day happens. And so, let's pray.
Lord, we thank you for this day.
Thank you for the message you've given to us and the books that you have for us to read and to understand how you've acted in history. Lord, help us to have soft hearts and to understand, to show compassion to the people around us. Help us be open to responding when people are having crises and to be your example of how to live out your life and how to alleviate their suffering. Lord, help us have our eyes to be open as we go out this day and this week, as we go back to work and school and everything else that we're doing. We ask you to soften our hearts, that we have time to rest and think about what you've provided for us and all things you have to say for us. Thank you for your Bible. Thank you for the Sabbath that we have to stop what we're doing and to refocus on what's really important. So thank you, Lord, and go with us as we leave this day. In Jesus' name.
We're going to sing hymn 79, Take Time to Be Holy. If you'd like to stand with us.
Father, we thank you for this day, for the sunshine outside, for the spring, for the flowers, for the opportunity.